Why do atoms and molecules go to therapy? Because they have serious bonding issues. That's right. Today, we're talking about atoms, the building blocks of you and me. All living things are built from these same fundamental components, the atom. Each atom has a dense core called the nucleus, where we find two particles, the protons and the neutrons. Protons are positively charged, so just remember P for proton, P for positive. Neutrons, on the other hand, are neutral. They don't have any charge. Constantly in motion around the nucleus are particles called electrons. These are negatively charged particles, and they can't resist the allure of the positive charge of the protons. So they're perpetually orbiting around the nucleus. Now, these atoms come in different varieties, each with a distinct personality. We call these varieties elements, and they are meticulously organized in the periodic table. Think of it as an apartment complex for the elements, each assigned with its own address. Now, each of these elements is defined by something called the atomic number. This is the number of protons that are found in its nucleus. So hydrogen, which is the smallest and most abundant element in the universe, has one proton. So its atomic number is one. Carbon, which we'll talk a lot about, the backbone of all organic molecules, has six protons. So it has an atomic number of six. And in the periodic table, you'll find this number located for each element. When we say organic in biology, we don't mean farm-to-table fresh food. Organic means something that contains carbon and hydrogen. As we progress through the next several lessons, you'll learn how important carbon is to life. Now let's switch gears and talk about isotopes. These are atoms of the same element, but they have a different number of neutrons. Now keep in mind, they're the same element, so they have the same number of protons. Think of it like this. You have two identical donuts, because who doesn't love donuts? But one is filled with jelly and the other one is plain. They look the same on the outside, but their inner contents, their mass, is different. It's the same idea with isotopes. The mass number of an atom means its protons plus its neutrons. Remember, these are the particles that are in the atom's nucleus. In our example, carbon 12 has six protons, six neutrons, and a mass of 12. Carbon 13, on the other hand, has six protons, seven neutrons, and therefore has a mass number of 13. Isotopes, while similar in many ways, can have vastly different properties. Some isotopes are unstable, meaning that they undergo something called radioactive decay. During this process, the unstable isotopes release energy as they become a more stable form. The unique characteristics of each isotope have actually proven valuable to scientists. One particular fascinating application of radioactive decay is used in archaeology and paleontology. This allows them to measure the specific amount of a radioactive isotope present in ancient remains like fossils. They can estimate then the age of the specimen. This is called radioactive dating, and it has revolutionized us understanding the history of life on our planet. The process of radioactive decay is often compared to a ticking clock because each isotope has its own unique half-life. That means the time it takes for half of the original amount of the isotope to decay. Some isotopes have half-life that spans billions of years, while others decay much more rapidly. Understanding these half-lives is crucial for accurately dating ancient material and unraveling the mysteries of our past. Now let's take a closer look at the structure of an atom using something called the Bohr model that was proposed by physicist Niels Bohr back in 1913. It's a simple representation, and it shows us how electrons are in energy levels called shells. And electrons can only move between these energy levels by absorbing or emitting specific amounts of energy. Atoms can join with other atoms and form compounds or molecules. When they do this, it's called a chemical bond. The outermost electrons, or those that are in what we call the valence shell, are what participates in this chemical bonding. Atoms can either share electrons or transfer electrons to form these chemical bonds. Remember, it's the valence electrons, it's the interaction of these that form the countless compounds and molecules that make up everything around us. From the water you drink to the air you breathe, it's all because of these tiny energetic particles and their ability to create chemical bonds. Now, although the Bohr model has limitations and it's been superseded by some more advanced theories like quantum mechanics, it's still very useful for us in an introductory biology class to understand the basic structure of an atom and the importance of energy levels and valence electrons in chemical bonding. Now, why do atoms form chemical bonds? This is all because of energy. It's to have a more stable energy level. By having a full outer or valence shell, they're more stable. Remember, that's the outermost shell where the electrons participate in bonding. To do this, some atoms will gain or lose electrons to fill their shell. And when they do that, they have an unequal number of protons versus electrons. This creates an ion. So if an atom has more protons than electrons, it will form a cation and be positively charged, T in the cation for positive. If there are more electrons than there are protons, it will form a negatively charged ion. This is called an anion. Now, in the animation, sodium is feeling particularly generous. It loses an electron and becomes a sodium cation or sodium plus. By losing this electron, sodium now has a full valence shell. Chlorine is always eager to accept an electron because when it does so, it has a full valence and it becomes the chloride anion, Cl-. It is now the opposite charges of our sodium cation and our chloride anion that create this strong attraction, forming the ionic bond. Compounds are what are created when these ionic bonds form. Now let's look at this relation to living things. All living things are made of mostly water. Our cells are about 70% water. So when ionic bonds are placed in water, the water molecules interrupt these ionic bonds and the ions dissociate or separate. This means you have charged ions traveling through your cells and through your blood. These are vital for many processes like your muscle contractions, sending your nerve signals. So when you pick up your coffee cup or when you move your mouse, it wouldn't happen if you didn't have ions in your body. But wait, atoms can also bond by sharing electrons. When electrons are shared, they create what's called a covalent bond. When they connect through covalent bonds, they form molecules. For example, we mentioned water earlier. In water, we have one oxygen and two hydrogen atoms that are sharing electrons. This forms H2O, the molecule you're probably already familiar with. These covalent bonds are incredibly strong, and it makes water a very stable molecule. However, not all atoms are going to share equally. Just because they share, they may not share equally. So covalent bonds can be polar or nonpolar, depending on how equally they share their electrons. In a polar covalent bond, like water, electrons are shared unequally. One atom hogs the electrons more of the time, and so one atom is more negative, the one that has the electrons. One atom might be more positive. In nonpolar, the electrons are shared equally. An example of this would be oxygen gas or methane. These variations in charge difference influence the way they interact with other molecules. This is really important for life on Earth. Now, let's go back and revisit the idea of the periodic table and see how electron shells are arranged. Elements in the first period have only one electron shells. In the second period, they have two, and it goes on and on down the periodic table. Now, elements in the same vertical columns or groups share something special. They have the same number of valence or outer electrons. So this similarity means that they have similar reactions in chemical reactions. It's like having a group of friends, right, that share the same interests. They act or behave the same way in certain situations. For example, the halogens in group 17 all have seven valence electrons. That makes them highly reactive because they're always searching for that one more electron to fill their outermost or their valence shell. Now, electronegativity is a term that says this is the atom's ability to attract electrons toward itself in a chemical bond. So it's like it's magnetism or pull for electrons. We use something called the Pauling scale to measure electronegativity, named after the brilliant chemist Linus Pauling. The scale ranges from 0.7 to 4, with fluorine being the highest value or the most powerful electron attractor. Across the periodic table, electronegativity generally is going to increase from left to right and from bottom to top. Why is that? Well, because atoms that are closer to fluorine on the periodic table tend to have higher electronegativity values. Fluorine, being the most electronegative element, sits at the top right corner of the table. Now let's talk more about bonding. When atoms with different electronegativities come together, they can form either these polar covalent or ionic bonds. In polar covalent bonds, the electrons are still shared, but unevenly because of that difference in electronegativity. This leads to what we call partial charges on atoms. In ionic bonds, the electrons are completely transferred. That's what creates the ions that we mentioned earlier with opposite charges. So, from the fundamental simplicity of an atom to the mind-boggling complexity of life, it all begins with these building blocks. Once you grasp these concepts, you're ready to decode the fascinating story of life itself. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like, share it with a friend who loves biology or needs to pass a test, and don't forget, leave me a comment to tell me what would you like to learn about next.